Tamam, şimdi YouTube'da yayına geçebiliyoruz. Neyse ki. Evet, tamam. Şu anda yayına geçmiş bulunuyoruz. Bir sıkıntı yok.
Tamam.
Tamam, başlayabiliriz. Tamam, öncelikle tanıtalım bugünkü sunucumuzu. Boğaziçi Üniversitesi'nden doktor öğretim üyesi Yeliz Kaçamak bugünkü konuğumuz. Türkiye Uzaktan İktisat Seminerlerinde ve kendisinin sunum başlığı Tax Enforcement with Somewhat Honest Taxpayers olacak. Sözü Yeliz'e bırakalım.
Teşekkürler. Öncelikle Ceyhun Güneş ve Aykut hocalara çok teşekkür ediyorum böyle bir oluşum başlattıkları için. Burada İngilizceye geçip devam edeceğim. I'm going to talk about my working paper titled Tax Enforcement with Somewhat Honest Taxpayers. Okay, I want to start with my research question and then I'm going to build on the motivation and then introduce the model afterwards. Okay. So the main research question is, do optimal audit rules derived from standard tax compliance models survive when taxpayers are lying over us? Okay. So when we look at developed countries and when we look at their tax revenue compositions, we see that bulk of the tax revenue collected is from individual income taxes. So this is a picture from the US where you can see that over the year, there is a lot of change in the corporate income tax and social insurance tax. However, the individual income tax is almost always around 40% of the tax revenue. So then being able to collect income tax is a big revenue source for these governments. And in most of these countries, the income tax is withheld from the paycheck, so it is collected at the source. But there are also individuals who have to self-report their earnings. And then this brings up the question, do they truthfully report their earnings? If they do truthfully report their earnings, why do they do that or why not? And how should the government deter and catch evasion? So this is from the OECD website where they looked at the labor force statistics. And as you can see, this is the percentage of self-employed in the total employment rate. And for a lot of countries like Turkey, Mexico, Brazil, this is really high. For more developed countries, it's a little bit lower. But thinking, for example, in terms of United States, given the population of the United States, there are a lot of people who are self-employed and whose taxes are not withheld at the source. Okay. So, but when we look at most tax compliance models in the literature, we see that this literature assumes taxpayers will underreport income to the extent that it benefits them monetarily. Okay. So if I think that from an expected use perspective, I gain money by underreporting my taxes, I will do it. And if possible, to the extreme extent. But when we look at especially behavioral economics literature, we see that there are a lot of behavioral concerns that play a non-trivial role. And today I'm going to focus one of them, which is lying aversion. And when I say lying aversion, I generally mean that if an individual incurs an intrinsic cost from deviating from the truth, I'm going to assume that that person is lying averse. So in this case, the truth is my actual income that I receive. And the more I evade, I'm going to assume that I have this intrinsic cost that I derive from this evasion. Okay. So the question then I want to ask is, all the optimal audit rules that we get in the standard models, are this robust to this observation? So, excuse me. So in the literature, depending on the model, what optimal audit rule you get is going to vary, but general consensus suggests that cutoff rules are optimal in most cases. And by cutoff rules, what I mean is that there is an income threshold that for a reported income, and if you report below that income threshold, you're audited. And if you report income above that income threshold, you are not audited, okay? And this is usually observed in an audit class. And what I mean by audit class is a group of people whose observable characteristics are exactly the same. The only heterogeneity then is their reported income. Like, for example, doctors living in the Detroit area can be an audit class, or doctors living in the Detroit area who have families or who are married can count as an audit class. So because in an audit class, the only observable heterogeneity is the reported income, the government has to base their audit rule on this reported income because there is nothing else they can use. So then within an audit class, only taxpayers who report below a threshold of reported income are going to be audited. Like, for example, again, let's think of the doctors living in the Detroit area, then the government can say that if you're a doctor living in the Detroit area, and if you report less than $100,000 of income, I'm gonna audit you. If you report more than $100,000 of income, I'm not going to audit you. So this is intuitive and also very counterintuitive from different points of view. So ultimately what happens is that imagine yourself being this doctor who is living in the Detroit area. And if, like, just think that you earn, let's say, $50,000 in a year, okay, which is quite low, but just for the sake of it, think about that. So then you know that if you evade, you're gonna get caught because you're below the audit threshold. So you will definitely report honestly. So everyone below the threshold is always going to report honestly. However, let's say you earn $150,000 and you know that as long as you report above $100,000, you're not going to be audited. So if you only care about your monetary payoff, what you're going to do is that you're going to report the threshold. And because the government commits to this rule, they have to audit everyone who is reporting honestly, but everyone who evades doesn't get audited, okay? So again, the big assumption in these models and the assumption that I'm gonna keep for the sake of just applying what is in the literature is that government is committed to this rule ex ante and cannot change it after observing real income. Because if they can, clearly this won't be an equilibrium. But the counterintuitive point of this is only lower income individuals who report honestly get audited, okay? So in the standard model, again, where we only consider monetary benefits, this is optimal because higher income individuals have a better opportunity for hiding their income. So I can mimic a lower income person easily if I have a lot of income, not even considering the cost of evasion, but I have more opportunity. I have a lot of people that I can mimic, okay? So because I can report low incomes, then it makes sense to not have really high probabilities for high incomes because then I'm deterring people from reporting high incomes, okay? So this means that the audit probability in the standard models has to be a decreasing function of the reported income. So as the report increases, the probability has to either stay constant or decrease. So this is a totally counterintuitive result because, you know, like on one point we know that these are people who are evading and we are not auditing them. And actually, if you look at the real world, this is also not the case in real world. So this is a picture I took from the Internal Revenue Service of the USS data book. And on the x-axis, we have the income brackets. And on the y-axis, we have fraction examined in percentage of all possible returns. So kind of the fraction of returns that are audited. And as you can see, for low income levels, the audit fraction is really low. But as we go higher in the income distribution, for example, in 2014, when IRS had a higher budget, they were actually auditing higher income people with a very high rate. Okay. So this picture is a little bit misleading because this considers the total income distribution in the country. And like I said, I'm considering just an audit class. But still, you know, taking audit class as the whole income distribution in the country, clearly this is not the case that like the models do not match the reality necessarily. So real life audit methods can vary depending on the country. Different countries have different methods, but most countries use computer scoring algorithms quite widely. And one of the methods the Internal Revenue Service in the US uses is called the discriminant inventory function system. So what happens is that individuals fill in tax forms and like answering a lot of questions, and then the system takes each line item and assigns and takes like a weighted average, some sort of weighted average of these line items, and assigns a single score to that return. If that score is really high, then you are more likely to get audited. So in other words, this is kind of like a cutoff audit rule, but what goes into that function is a state secret, and you can't really get that information publicly. So therefore, we don't really know, but according to the IRS website, we can say that this resembles a cutoff audit rule. So then the cutoff audit rules are not that far from the reality. Okay. So then in this paper, I want to develop a model of tax compliance where I have risk neutral taxpayers and homogeneously lying averse taxpayers. So these are two big assumptions. First of all, I'm assuming risk neutral taxpayers. This is very common in the literature. It is, of course, not that realistic, but when you have risk-averse agents, the most of the models gets extremely complicated, so a lot of people just work with risk-neutral taxpayers and then try to extrapolate from that. And the reason that I'm assuming homogeneous lying-averse is that I see this as the first step of my exercise, and I want to see with this basic assumption how things change, and in the future, I want to relax this assumption, okay? And I show that even with this one tweak in the existing literature, the canonical cutoff audit rule is not optimal anymore. And which means that whatever the literature uses cannot be used as the optimal audit rule if we have lying averse agents, for example, okay? I also show that the standard model is the limiting case of the model presented here. So as lying aversion converges to zero, the optimal audit rule also converges to a cutoff rule. And I think the most interesting result out of this is that the fact that the optimal audit probability does not need to be non-decreasing in reported income. In other words, I can successfully audit higher reports without violating some sort of incentive compatibility rule in this case, which I believe is closer to the real life cases. Okay, so I first want to introduce the canonical model that I'm gonna base on. And this is from Sanchez and Sobel 1993 J-PAVI paper, where they have taxpayers, and I'm gonna keep their notation as well. Taxpayers are characterized by their incomes, and this is identically and independently distributed by a density. And they also have risk neutral agents. And these taxpayers choose how much income to report, either to maximize their utility or minimize tax payments, which is the same because of the risk neutrality assumption. And the tax agency only observes reported income. Again, remember, we are in an audit class. So everything else about these people are the same except the reported income. And tax agency taxes taxpayers with an increasing tax function. This is exogenously given, so you can think of as government having two levels, and the higher level of government already chose the tax function and the penalties, and the lower level of government, which is the tax agency, has to choose the audit probability. And they choose this audit probability to maximize net tax revenue, but of course, each audit is costly, and the marginal cost of each audit is K dollars. And again, I keep this assumption, the government is committed to this rule ex ante and cannot change it after observing real income, okay? So an audit reveals true income. So this means that this is not just audit probability, but this is also the detection probability, which can be different in real life, of course, you can get audited, but it's possible that your evasion is not uncovered. But here I'm assuming that each audit reveals all true income. So you have to pay the evaded tax, and on top of that, you have to pay a penalty on the evaded tax so that evasion is kind of deterred through this, okay? So if you look at the taxpayer's utility, then the taxpayer chooses R to maximize their utility. And if there is no detection, if they get away with evasion, this is the tax payments that they have to make, okay? But if there is detection, if they're cultivating, they already made the tax payments on the reported income. So here, this is the actual tax owed on there. So I remember is their real income. So this is the tax I owe on my real income. This is the tax I already paid. So this difference is the evaded tax. So I have to pay the evaded tax. And on top of that, I have to pay this fine that is a function of the evaded tax as well. Okay. So then we can write the agent's problem as if she's minimizing her total cost, which is her total tax payments, expected total tax payments. So this is what you pay regardless of the state of the world. And this is the portion that brings the uncertainty into this problem. If I choose a reported income that is less than my actual income, then with probability P, this is going to be uncovered and I have to pay this extra fine and the remaining evaded tax, okay? So a couple of observations. So first of all, in this model, no one will overreport their true income because there is no reward for paying more taxes than you need to. And the other thing is everyone will report honestly if the probability rate is greater than 1/1 + pi, okay? So this means that this is the probability where probability is equal to 1/1 + pi is enough to deter people from reporting a report. Like for example, let's say I have again $100,000 and the probability for reporting, let's say $0 is 1/1 + pi, then this is going to imply that for me, reporting my true income, which is $100,000, is better than reporting zero income when I earn $100, okay? So then because audit is costly, this is the highest probability rate that I will ever choose as the government, okay? So the intuition, the Sanchez-Sobel model is a little bit complicated, so I don't wanna go over how they solve everything, but I just want to give the intuition of how they get this audit probability. What they do is they treat this audit problem as an auction of a bad. So rather than auctioning a good where you have values and then you want to award the good to the person with the highest value, what they think of it is that now they are auctioning a bad and the probability of audit is the probability of receiving this bad, okay? So then, as in the actual audit problem, remember people have the incentive to over-report their types usually. But in this case, I have the incentive to underreport my type because I don't want to win the auction in this case. So just applying regular mechanism design tools, which you can easily find in Muscle, Alviston, Green, this problem leads to an optimal cutoff rule, okay? And for these tools to be applicable, the reward function has to be monotone. So in the auction models, the probability of delivering this good to a person has to increase with the value. In this case, it's the opposite situation. The probability of receiving an audit has to decrease in true value, which is the income, which therefore has to increase in reported income, okay? So then, keeping that on the side, what I do is I take everything and I change one thing. So now I have taxpayers who incur a cost of lying, which is just theta, and this is common knowledge. The government knows this, individual themselves know it. And I also know everyone else has this theta. So then what changes is that the tax payments, so this part is exactly the same as the Sanchez and Sobel model, but now I have this certain cost whenever I evade, okay? So what happens is, this again doesn't depend on probability because I personally know that I evaded and I feel bad about it, okay? So of course, like a more sophisticated model might add another cost here because it's possible that when you are caught evading, your cost is different. But because I want to isolate just this simple addition, I'm not gonna consider that for now, okay? So this lying cost is equal to zero if your lying cost parameter is theta is equal to zero. So the standard model is this, where theta is just equal to zero. And it's also equal to zero if you report truthfully. You do not incur any costs when you report truthfully. And you also do not receive any reward, intrinsic reward, when you report truthfully as well. And as lying aversion increases, I assume that this cost function also increases. And I also assume that the cost of lying increases in the size of lying. So then intrinsic cost of evasion increases in the amount that you evade. For example, let's say again, you have $100,000, you're gonna incur more cost if you report zero compared to the case that you report $90,000. I also wanted to get rid of like a corner solution type of thing where people just over-report income just to feel good about themselves. So then I'm assuming that over-reporting income is not rewarded by this function, okay? So the this couple of observations we had with the Sanchez and Sobel model still applies here. The first one is that no one will over-report. And the second one is that 1 over 1 plus pi as the probability is enough to deter everyone from reporting a certain report, okay? So then solving this problem, we need to satisfy these three conditions. So let's say that R star I is the optimal report of taxpayer with income I, then this function should satisfy, first of all, incentive compatibility constraint. So in other words, someone whose income is I should not act like someone whose income is J, okay? So this doesn't mean that someone whose income is I shouldn't report J. It just means that given that everyone is behaving according to this function, I will only report R star I, but I won't report R star J, okay? And of course, the first order conditions should be satisfied and the envelope condition should also be satisfied, okay? So I know this looks ugly, but just bear with me for a second. So any probability function and the intrinsic cost of lying should satisfy these two conditions, okay? So this first one comes from incentive compatibility argument from this part. And the second one comes from the envelope condition, okay? So now first focus on this incentive compatibility condition, okay? So this says that, I didn't put it here, but the optimal income increase, optimal reported income increases with income. So this says that if a person I earns more than person J, then the probability of this report should be such that person I wouldn't want to mimic person J, okay? So now for a second, go back to the standard model. So and assume that these are just zero because in that standard model, there is no cost. So this is just going to boil down to the fact that probability of report of person J should be higher than the probability of audit of report of person I. So this is where the monotonicity assumption in the original model comes from. So this says that the report of a person with income 50,000, for example, should be audited more frequently compared to the report of a person who earns $100,000, okay? But when I have costs, this changes a little bit. So there is still some sort of monotonicity argument. So this gives me a bound on how different two probabilities should be. But this also allows me that it's possible that, for example, this is negative, whereas this is positive or vice versa. So this means that now I don't always have to have PRJ greater than PRI, okay? So this cost function here gives me an extra flexibility, which is good for interpreting the results and then for kind of mimicking a more real world example. So I'll skip the proofs. So the corollary from this proposition is that without lying aversion, a feasible audit probability function has to be non-decreasing in reported income. However, with just a small tweak of adding this homogeneous lying cost, what we have is the function doesn't have to be monotone anymore. Okay. So just I want to give you the intuition why this is happening in this model rather than just showing the equations. So the reason that in the standard model, this P has to be monotone is because if P is not non-decreasing, you will lower your report and gain something out of it. Okay, so think of this case. So if, let's say again, I'm earning $100,000 and the government says that if you report zero, I'm gonna audit you with probability, I don't know, like 1/4. But if you report 100,000 or let's say 99,000, I'm gonna audit you with probability 1/2, which is a higher probability. So then when you give the higher report, you actually pay more taxes and the probability of you getting caught is higher. So this gives incentive to you to switch to zero. So zero, this reporting zero dominates reporting 99,000. So start from zero then, right? So the government wants to make sure that no one reports zero unless they earn zero income, right? So then I will audit zero with 1/1 plus pi probability, which is the deterring rate of probability. So I'll start with zero. I'll audit that as frequently as I can, so no one reports that. So now move to $1. Right, so I also don't want people to just report $1 because that will be a lot of loss in tax revenue. So I want to deter people from reporting that. So I audit that $1 as the highest audit level that I can. And then I keep going this way, starting from the lowest possible report. And then at some point my budget runs out, so I stop, okay? So this is the intuition behind the result in the standard model. But when I add lying aversion, what happens is that, imagine again someone with $100,000, even if the government says that I will not audit you if you report zero, because they're gonna feel really bad about not paying taxes at all, their evasion is going to be bonded. So there's going to be a bond. So no one is going to lie to the extreme extent in this case. So once I remove the fact that now you don't have to audit zero at the highest probability, you can take that money from there and then kind of start distributing it to higher reports, okay? So even if a report is audited by probability zero, higher reports can still be audited with a positive probability without deterring people from reporting higher income levels, okay? So then if we want to find the optimal audit function, this is the problem that we need to solve, where this TIP is the expected tax payments of a single individual. And this is considering the income distribution, then this is the total expected tax payments that I can have in the country. So this is the audit rate. This is how much I pay per audit. And again, this is the total, given the income distribution, this is the total number of audits that I can conduct without going over my budget. And of course, assuming that the individual chooses the optimal report, okay? So here, if I want to solve this without assuming that this P is monotone, I face a lot of difficulties. So first of all, the domain of this choice variable is the set of all probability distributions. And because unless I assume a certain property on that, then it's almost impossible to solve this problem. And I can't use the tools from the mechanism design, okay? So right now I don't have a solution to this problem, but what I wanna do next is that I want to show you that under some maybe strict assumptions, the cutoff audit rule can be dominated by just a random audit probability rule. Okay, so I put aside the tax agency's problem for now. Next, I want to show you that there are better things than cutoff audit rule under certain cases, okay? So I'm gonna skip this. This is just showing that if theta is zero, then the problem is the same as the Sanchez and Solow. Okay, so Now let's assume that I have a linear text schedule and I'm assuming a convex lying, easy convex lying reversion function here. So this is the weighted income. This theta is the lying reversion parameter. And I'm just going to assume that my income is distributed by uniform, okay? So again, if I was considering the total income distribution in the country, this will be a crazy assumption to assume that the income in a country is distributed by uniform distribution. However, again, think that I'm in an audit class. So within an audit class, it's not that weird to assume a uniform distribution, okay? So a general, so if there was no cost function, lying aversion component included, then applying Sanchez and Sobel will tell me that this is the best way to audit in this economy. And what you do is you audit all reports that are less than a threshold, which is A here, with the highest probability you can that deters people from evading. And then above this cutoff, you don't audit anyone, okay? And then you choose this cutoff again until the point where you exhaust your budget. So then, if this is the rule, and again, remember, this is announced by assumption and then the government cannot go back on their word. So I'm gonna have three types of people in the economy. Okay, so I'm gonna have people who report truthfully. These are all the people who already earn income less than a threshold. And I'm gonna have some people who report exactly the threshold. And if I'm in the Sanchez and Sobel world, these are the two types of people I have, okay? But including the lying aversion, now I'm going to have a group of additional people who evade by a constant amount. So this constant amount comes from the fact that I have this basic function. If I have a different function, it might not be constant. But the point is that these people do not evade to the extreme extent they can. So then the optimal reporting schedule for taxpayers is going to look like this, okay? So if I have income less than A, I'm gonna report truthfully. If I'm in this kind of like this area between A and A plus T theta, I'm gonna report the threshold. And if I earn more income than this, I'm going to evade by this constant amount here, okay? So this is, of course, a little bit realistic because I'm assuming that if you earn like $100,000, you evade $1,000. And if you earn $5,000, maybe you still evade $1,000. Okay. So then, given this simple model, what we can do is we can actually now think of a constant probability of audit. Okay. So instead of this cutoff rule, I say that I'm gonna audit everyone with a constant probability. And I choose this probability based on my budget. So I exhaust my budget, but I audit everyone, okay? So in this case, the optimal report, just taking the first order condition of the taxpayer, the optimal report is my income minus this here, okay? And this time depends on the probability, which is defined by this, and then the fine that the higher level of the government has already chosen. Okay. And I just gave some parameter values because like I said, this is an exercise to see, are there certain cases where just the random audit rule, which is not optimal at all, can still behave better than the cutoff rule. And we can see that the total revenue is actually higher with this just random audit rule that I randomly selected, okay? So for me, this is enough motivation to show that these optimal audit rules are not good enough when we consider additional behavioral concerns. So again, the reason that I get this result is the higher income individuals don't have a better opportunity to evade anymore. They still have a better opportunity to evade, but they don't have the best opportunity to evade anymore. So I can just start auditing these people and still catch them and collect their money because they themselves feel bad from evading, okay? So then in this case, the tax agency can audit everyone and raise revenue rather than focusing on lower incomes, okay? So just as a discussion, even though I presented this paper as lying aversion, And this can actually be applied to any other situation. As long as I have a cost of evasion that is unrelated to the probability, this will have the similar implications, okay? Because the idea is that as long as evasion is bounded for some reason, then I can still audit high income level people without forcing them to switch to zero reporting or as low as they can report it, okay? So a couple of examples to this, like for example, let's say you want to borrow money and you know that lenders examine your tax returns. And if you underreport your income, the amount of loan that you're gonna get is going to depend on the income that you reported in your tax returns. So maybe you don't wanna report too low, even though you thought that you can get away with it. And of course, the most common and lying aversion can actually be in this group too, tax moral type considerations. Also stigma, which not 100% applies, but kind of applies, or even social norms. So anything that bounds your evasion is going to give me the same result, okay? So just a couple of caveats that I want to mention is that here the optimal audit rule depends on the income distribution. So I haven't solved for the optimal audit rule, but I can say that it's gonna depend on the income distribution. Compared to the case where Sanchez and Sobel, it does not accept finding the threshold. So I don't think this is a bad thing because I think that the audit rule should depend on the income distribution. And I think this is actually a positive thing that I get from this model. And one thing that I also want to point out here is that I'm maximizing the net tax revenue and I'm not maximizing social welfare. And usually our aim is to maximize social welfare, but choosing welfare criteria in this case is quite tricky because lying cost depends on evaded income. So if the government wants to take lying costs into account, they have to know the evaded income. And if they know the evaded income, then we don't really have a problem. We don't even have to solve this, okay? So the other thing is, of course, the lying aversion model assumed here is highly stylized and everyone is lying averse to the same degree. And the problem gets quite complex if taxpayers are heterogeneous in their level of lying aversion, but I think that will be a good addition once I can solve the optimal audit rule with the homogeneous ones and then somehow say something about the heterogeneous levels of lying aversion. So in conclusion, in this paper, I show that the canonical cutoff audit rule does not survive a model that simplistically incorporates lying aversion. And even though this model is quite stylized, it provides many insights. And two of the most important ones is that the tax agency does not have to focus on low income levels necessarily when they're choosing their audit function. And the income distribution plays a non-trivial role in designing the optimal audit rule, which I think is the case in real life, okay? So a natural addition to this working paper will be, of course, to solve the optimal audit rule. And if you have any ideas on how to attack that problem mathematically, I will be super happy to hear that. Also, I think adding some third-party information and accounting for variation in the third-party reported income might also give some comparative statistics, which might be nice. Or maybe including a fixed cost of lying might change things a little bit too, which, you know, this recent paper, which looks at lying aversion, suggests that this is actually how people perceive the cost of lying. And I think it will be interesting to look at, like, if I have an income distribution that has a thick top tail, because then I'm not only talking about an audit class, I can also say something more about the regular income distribution in the country as well, okay? So I don't know if I'm early, or on time, but yes, thank you, everyone. Hello.
Giriş hocam, teşekkür ederiz.
Sesi bilgisayarın sesini kısmışım, o yüzden konuşayım. Ben teşekkür ederim.
Chat window'a hemen bakmaya çalışıyorum ama benim internetim koptu.
Tamam. Chat'te ben de görmüyorum chat'te açıkçası soru şu an.
Tamam. O zaman soruları alabiliriz. Ceyhun Hoca YouTube'a bakacaktı herhalde, o da bir şeyler şimdi sonra. Arada hem Ceyhun Hoca'nın hem benim internetimde galiba sorunlar oldu.
Anladım.
Aykut Hocam sesiniz hiç gelmiyor.
Öyle mi? Biraz bağırayım mı? Tamam.
Evet,
tamam.
Şimdi daha iyi.
Tamam, şimdi soruları alabiliriz. Eğer mikrofonla bağlanmak isteniyorsa mikrofonla da sorabilir. Chat'ten de sorabilirler. Tamam. Birileri düşünüyor. Ben sorayım bir soru.
Tamam. Ben de şimdi YouTube'a baktım ama sadece neden Türkçe yayın yapmıyorsunuz diye sorum. Paper'le ilgili sorum.
Onu birkaç kez duyurduk sonuçta. Konuşmacıların inisiyatifine bıraktığımızı söylemiştik. Ben şeyi sorayım. Yani bu lying aversion'ın aslında, evet, sen hani şeyi söyledin, heterojen olması ilginç olabilir dedin. Ama aynı zamanda bir de aslında gelire bağlı olması daha temelde hani ilginç bir şey olmaz mı? Ya da başka bir yani burada işte biraz daha davranışsal temelleri olabilir mi acaba?
Yani şöyle.
Yani bir tür hani şu prospect teorideki gibi hani yüksek gelirlerde evet. Farklı, düşük gelirlerde farklı olması gibi.
Yani şöyle olur.
O kadar önemli olacak da.
Şöyle olabilir hani yüksek gelirde daha az yalan söylemeyi seviyorsun ya da daha çok yalan söylemeyi seviyorsun dediğim noktada çok farklı bir yere çekmiş oluyorum muhabbeti ya. O yüzden hani ondan kaçındım ama şöyle olabilir. Bu evasion'ın size'ından değil de evasion income'a göre oranı üzerinden belki değerlendirilebilir. Yani mesela işte atıyorum kafadan 100 bin dolar kazanıyorsam 50 bin dolar evade ettiğimde yarısını evade etmiş oluyorum. Ama 50 bin dolar kazanan biri her şeyi evade etmiş oluyor. Hani o yüzden aynı, birebir aynı karaktere sahip olsalar da aynı cost'i derive etmeyebilirler. Evet, o kesinlikle katılabilir. Ama birebir income'ın daha yüksekse Titan'da daha yüksek olur demek şöyle iyi olabilir. Çünkü ben heterogeneous yaptığımda bu sefer income distribution'la lying aversion distribution, joint distribution'ını consider etmem gerekecek bir noktada. Hani aslında böyle bir assumption yapmak o noktada işimi çok kolaylaştırır.
Anladım. Ama joint'ler üzerinden çözülebilir.
Evet. Ama hani justify edebilir miyim emin değilim. Çünkü hani o zaman hani zenginler daha kötü hissediyor yalan söyleyince ya da daha iyi hissediyorlar yalan söyleyince gibi bir şey interpret etmişim.
Şeye baktım yani davranışsal iktisat literatüründe bu behavioralcılar bir şey diyorlar mı? Hani bu tür bir şey
evet.
Var mı?
Yani o Ginizzi paper'ına bayağı baktım. Zaten o paper'dan biraz yola çıkarak bunu düşünmeye başlamıştım. Orada genelde income'la ilgili bir şey söylenmiyor. Çünkü lab experiment'lara baktıkları için hani insanların income'larını çok göz önüne almamışlar.
Doğru.
Ama orada şey deniyor mesela. Yani belki size arttıkça cost artmıyor olabilir. Ama kesinlikle fix bir cost var gibi bir çıkarımları vardı. Bayağı oldu o paper'a bakalı bir 2-3 sene ama.
Bir de ama son biraz cahilce olabilir. Çünkü daha önce hiç bu tür problemleri hani öyle bilgisayarda falan yapmayı denemedim ama en son hatta mikro derslerinde bıraktım bu dersleri alırken. Ama şöyle bir şey aklıma geldi. Yani problemi bir şekilde discrete hale getirip acaba brute force'la hani bilgisayarda bir şey denemek mümkün olabilir mi?
Evet. Ben de bir iki mühendis arkadaşım bunu sorduğumda benzer bir şey aldım. Bir noktada zaten hani ya bu agent based modeling olarak bir şekilde simülasyona çevirip hani böyle equilibrium convergence var mı ya da belli yerlere convergence var mı diye.
Evet evet. Yani genetik algoritma falan işe yarayabilir burada. Yani discrete hale getirirsen bence bir şey olabilir. Bir çıkış yolu olabilir. En azından yani numerik olarak optimal şeyi karakterize edebilirsin belki.
Evet,
teşekkürler.
Evet.
Ağzına sağlık. Çok ilginç.
Ben teşekkür ederim. Sorularınız için de çok güzel sorular sordunuz.
Aykut Hocam ben şey yapabilir miyim? Soru sorabilir miyim?
Buyurun. Harun Hocam buyurun.
Çok teşekkür ediyorum. Yedis Hocam ağzınıza sağlık. Ya bir dersin grading ile ilgili birkaç tane mesaj geldi. Birazcık şey oldum ama konsantrasyonum bozuldu. Çok özür dilerim. Acil cevap vermem gerekiyordu. Kaçırdıysam bize bakma ama şeyi merak ettim ben. Bu bir kere income tax evasion değil mi? Profit tax evasion böyle bir ayrım.
Yok, evet evet. Bunu baştan söylemeliydim. Ben hep unutuyorum. Ben bu sunumu daha önce kendi okulumda sadece böyle public finance'çilere yaptım. General audience'a şey yaparken bazı şeyleri.
Bazı sorulara alışkın değilim diyorsun.
Yok yok şeyden yani evet. Bu sadece individual taxation.
Tamam yani evet. O zaman tabii başka şeyler de soracaktım ama o zaman eğer sadece income tax evasion'sa iki tane sorum var. Bir tanesi bracketleri daraltmanın şeyi, bu income bracketleri. daraltmak şeyi auditing cost'u azaltır mı? Onun etkisi ne olur? Yani ne yapar onu bir merak ettim. Bir de income bracket tanımlamanın yanında bir de böyle strict sektörel şeyler yapsak. Ayrımlar yapsak. Çünkü sektör şeylerinde yani average income'lar çok işte belli olacağı için değil mi? Şeyi kolaylaştırabilir yani hakikaten. Auditing cost'u azaltır. Hemen anlayabilirsin bu sektörde, X sektörde, X şeyin değil mi? İşte individual'ı ne kadar income elde edebileceğini daha net şey yapabiliriz. Dolayısıyla evasion olup olmadığını daha kolay anlayabilir miyiz diye. Çok teşekkür ediyorum ağzına.
Ben teşekkür ederim sorularınız için de. Şimdi ilk soruya cevap olarak aslında ben burada şey yani bir devlet tax sistemi oluştururken tabii ki tax rate'den, income bracket'larından ne bileyim bir sürü şeyi seçiyor. Ama ben burada şu an bunu düşünürken şöyle düşünüyorum. Üst seviyedeki devletin üst seviyesindeki grup çoktan bu tax rate'i ve bir sürü şeyi seçmiş. Bunu baz alarak biz probability of detection seçmeye çalışıyoruz gibi düşünüyorum. Ama tabii ki aslında böyle hani buradan istediğim gibi bir audit probability çıkartabilsem oradan bir üst seviyeye gidip peki böyle bir durumda tax rate'i nasıl seçersiniz ya da nasıl bir tax sistemi seçersiniz diye düşünebilirim. Ki o çok şeyi değiştirecektir mesela. Burada tax'e increasing diyorum sadece. Ama mesela continuous olduğunda varsayıyorum. Mesela bracket'lar varsa, arada bunching ya da kink oluyorsa aslında o fonksiyon farklı implikasyonlar kesinlikle yaratabilir. O yüzden hani cevabını direkt söyleyemiyorum. Ama kesinlikle farklı bir şey çıkar diye düşünüyorum. İkinci sorunuza olarak da evet aynen. Yani zaten gerçek hayatta da şeye inanmak çok mantıklı olmaz yani. Hani şimdi diyelim ben trilyonları olan bir insanım. İşte 50 bin dolar audit $50,000 report ediyorsam ama mesela işte başka bir insan diyelim işte Amerika'da hoca olan bir insan $50,000 report ediyorsa ikimizin aynı ihtimalle audit edilmesi çok saçma. Evet. O yüzden bu audit class diye ayırmaya çalıştım. Çünkü audit class'ta şeye bakıyor mesela işte şöyle varsayıyorum. The government bakıyor. Diyor ki işte sen işte atıyorum kafadan bilmem nerede profesörsün. İşte bu aynı zamanda evlisin. Eşin şu işi yapıyor. İşte şurada şu neighborhood'da yaşıyorsun gibi. Bunların hepsinin sabit olduğu bir grup içinde audit probability seçtiğimi düşünerek hesaplıyorum. Anladım. Yani aslında o sektörel değişiklikleri işin içine katmış oluyoruz. Anladım. Implied bir şekilde ama dediğiniz doğru kesinlikle. Çünkü tek sadece report üzerinden zaten o yüzden hani genel income distribution demek istemedim. Çünkü o zaman aslında yanlış bir iş yapmış oluyorum. O yüzden audit class içinde düşünüyorum. Yani ülkeyi gruplara ayırıp o gruplar içinde her bir grup için nasıl bir audit rate yaratmalıyız gibi.
Çok teşekkür ederim.
Ben teşekkür ederim. Bakıyorum YouTube'dan da başka soru var mı diye. YouTube'da da yok herhalde.
YouTube'dan tek gelen soru niçin Türkçe yayın yapmıyorsunuz diye bir soru var ama onu şu an için cevaplamamız çok mümkün. Yani onun tercihine bırakıyoruz hani sunuculara. Evet. Sonuçta bilim dili İngilizce, bunu kabul etmek lazım ve bu yani bu yorum birkaç defa daha geldi burada daha belki sunumlarda. İngilizce yapanlar oldu, Türkçe yapanlar oldu. Hani Türkçe yapılsın diye böyle bir talep oluyor ve Türkçe sunumlar biraz daha fazla ilgi görüyor. Ama evet, hani burada takip eden öğrenci arkadaşlara da söyleyelim yani sonuçta hani dünyada bilim dili İngilizce ve bu dili de mükemmel olmanız yani bu dili bilmeniz gerekiyor ki bilimi takip edesiniz veya yapasınız. Bir de burada vurgulamış evet. Olalım.
Çiğdem sorun var galiba. Sorabilirsin.
Evet, geliyor mu sesim acaba?
Aha geliyor. Ha,
çok teşekkürler, çok güzel bir sunumdu. Ben şey merak ettim Yeliz Hocam. Bu kaçırmış olabilirim orayı yani internet kesiliyor falan biraz ama. Bu feeling bad kısmını tam anlayamadım. Yani onu belli bir threshold üzerinde biz assume mu ediyoruz? Hani bu tax evade ederlerse kötü hissederler gibi bir assumption'ınız mı oldu yoksa sonuç gibi mi oldu? Biraz orayı kaçırdım da onu sormak istedim. Çok teşekkür ederim.
Assume ediyorum. Evet, ha, onu, tamam. onu direkt modele empoze ediyorum yani. Herkes benzer şekilde vergi kaçırdığını kötü hissettiğini varsayıyor.
Herkes için bunu değil mi? Yani belli evet. Bir threshold üzeri için değil.
Yok, aynen herkes için.
Anladım, tamam.
Zaten burada da zaten ilk Aykut Hoca'nın sorduğu soruya biraz gitmiş oldum.
Evet, evet.
Evet, belki herkes aynı hissetmiyor olabilir. Bu insana evet. bağlı olabilir. Farklı karakteristiklere bağlı olabilir. Ya bir noktada yani bütün income distribution'la heterogeneous bir line conversion belki atayamayabilirim. Çünkü o dediğim gibi joint distribution'ları consider etmem gerekeceğinden iyice komplikeleştirecek. Ama belki böyle hani bir grup hiç yalan söylemekten rahatsız olmuyor. Bir grup çok rahatsız oluyor gibi. Bir iki tane tam böyle olmasa da biraz bu tarz şeyleri consider eden paper'lar var. Belki onların metodlarını adopt edebilirim bir şekilde. Ama evet. Yani şimdi
değil mi? Evet, tamam. Tamamdır.
Evet.
Çok teşekkür ederim. Tamam, şimdi anladım ben de. Teşekkürler. Ama vardır herhalde değil mi? Yani onu relax edebileceğiniz herhalde literatürde vardır.
Evet. Vardır. Yani direkt audit probability çözen paper bilmiyorum öyle bir relaxation'la. Ama hani öyle bir relaxation'la farklı şeylere bakan.
Tamam, anladım.
Şeyler.
Tamam, çok teşekkürler. Çok güzeldi gerçekten.
Ben teşekkür ederim. Başka soru yok herhalde o zaman.
Evet, yok gibi gözüküyor herhalde. Çok teşekkür ederiz Yeliz.
Teşekkür ederiz Yeliz hocam.
Ben çok teşekkür ederim.
Geçenlerde YouTube'dan tekrarını izleyebilirler. Orada yayın kalacak illa nihai olarak.
Eğer sonradan aklına bir şey gelen, bir yorum yapmak isteyen ya da sorusu olan varsa da bu e-mail adresine bana sorularını iletebilir her zaman.
Çok teşekkürler. Burada bir de duyuru yapmış olalım. Yarın semineri sunacak olan Ayşegül Kayaoğlu bir rahatsızlığı nedeniyle yarınki semineri iptal etmek durumunda kaldık. Önümüzdeki hafta 25 Mayıs Pazartesi günü Cevat Girayaksoy ile devam edeceğiz seminerde. Herkese görüşmek dileğiyle diyelim.
Görüşmek üzere.
Görüşmek üzere.
Herkese.